Ivy Farm Technologies was created in 2019 as a spin-out from the University of Oxford. On the outskirts of the city is the company's headquarters, and as you'd expect from a cell cultivator, it doesn't look like your typical farm. When we visited, Manuela Donetti, Ivy Farm's head of product development, cooked a beef prototype made with 90% plant-based protein and 10% cultivated meat cells.
That's interesting. It smells a little bit different to what you would get in the supermarket with a farmed cut of meat, but the texture looks very similar. I'll leave it to you to do the cooking. So Manuela, how much testing do you usually have to do to know that this is safe to be eaten?
So we look if there is any microorganism inside our cells. Mm. At the moment, of course, until we are not regulated, approved, we can't really give people to eat our cells.
So I wouldn't be able to taste it?
No, I'm afraid not, sorry.
Can you describe to me the taste of it though?
The taste is really meaty and really brings back the umami flavor that you have usually with meat, and it covers really well the typical plant-based aftertaste that you have on a pure plant-based product.
This is just one of Ivy Farm's products. It also produces bao buns, burgers, meatballs and gyozas. All are made with cultivated beef, Ivy Farm's focus produce. I took a tour of the labs to see what goes into making them. Caitlin Duran is an associate scientist.
We kind of start with getting a very small tissue sample. At the minute, we're really going with a beef product, so Aberdeen Angus, Wagyu, and we kind of go through a process of extracting the cells out of that tissue. Out of all of that tissue, there's really only a small number of cells that we're actually really interested in that really have that ability to thrive in our environment that we put them in. We go through a process of training the cells, putting them through a bit of stress to really work out which are those really top performers that we have.
And where are you getting the initial tissues from?
So currently we have a really great partnership with a company in Northern Ireland. So the tissue that we get is actually animals that they are already taking for slaughter for their own meat purposes. In the future, we really won't be hoping to go back to anything that's dead. But also ideally, once we've kind of got those cells, we really don't have need to go back to the animal anyway.
Once the cell lines have been selected, they are grown in suspension in a culture media. Sharat Warrior is head of cell culture media R&D.
Cell culture media, think of it as a soup and essentially has all the nutrients the cells need. Different cell types have different requirements. For example, our beef has high levels of omega-3 and omega-6. That's because of our engineering of the cells.
What's the next step then?
Before we go into production, what we need to ensure is that the population of cells and the cell culture media is absolutely sterile, and essentially everything is antibiotic free.
Sterilization and testing complete, the cells grow on a small scale in plates or flasks before being put into these big mixing tanks called bioreactors. The largest one is called Betty, and she used to make insulin. Now though, she's been repurposed to hold up to 600 litres and make around 3 tonnes of meat per year.
You can think of what comes out of our bioreactors as something like a pâté, essentially, minced product. And then we're experimenting with a plant protein to make it look and feel and taste a lot like beef products you would buy in the supermarket today.
Ivy Farm estimates that the process from cell sample to mince will eventually take around 3 weeks. There isn't a price tag yet for its products, but the expectation is that it will take a while for cultivated meat to reach price parity with traditional meat. Harsh Amin is Ivy Farm's CEO and CSO.
I think to start with, just like any other nascent industries, you know, this cultivated meat industry also goes through a cost curve. So when you, for example, go to buy Aberdeen Angus, typically costs $10 to $15 a kilo. Our process and our R&D is focused to achieve that kind of a cost matrix. And only then we can really make a true difference on the sustainability goals when you go full scale.
But first, the company will need to seduce consumers.
Ultimately, this is going to go down to educating consumers, essentially, that look, this is not different than the real meat.
Ivy Farm's goal is to sell its products to food companies for them to mix with farmed or plant-based meat.
The way we envisage is it's a generation one paste that can be mixed with the plant-based meat can be mixed with normal animal meat. But that's a first step. As we scale up, then essentially that should have a Gen 2, Gen 3, and the texture and so on.
Scalability will take time. Despite Betty's impressive output, it will still take a lot more like her to satisfy the demand of, say, an average city's meat consumption. So partnerships are key. Another hurdle to overcome is regulatory approval. Ivy Farmers submitted its products for consideration by food governing bodies in the US, the UK, and Singapore, and expects to be able to go to market by the end of 2025.